Hello students, this is Dr. Madhu Kamra with a video lecture on Arnold's The Function of Criticism at the Present Time. Arnold contributed to literary journals, he wrote for Wards, selections from criticism from the English poets, which were published in Aces in Criticism in two series, first in 1865 and second in 1888. This essay appeared in 1865 in Aces in Criticism. And it established critical writing as important as great literature. This essay was also a protest against Wordsworth for devaluing critical writing, and it also shows his concern for Victorian age lagging behind in producing good literature because of their failure in critical inquiry. So it establishes the vitality of criticism as well as makes creativity flourish within a society. It also establishes the order of new ideas and simultaneously makes the best ideas gain more currency and hence establishes the majesty of the vocation of a critic. Now, coming to the structure of the essay, you will find that it lays down the definition of criticism at the very outset and also establishes its functional need. It also makes an elaborate detail about the qualification which is necessary for a great critic. And also distinguishes utility and significance of creative faculty from critical one, and assigns a cultural function to criticism. On this, he gives utmost emphasis. So coming on Arnold's views on criticism, he says that criticism is required for the dissemination of ideas, a disinterested endeavor to learn and propagate the best that is known and thought in the world. It is not purely and merely an act of judgment, but a disinterested judgment, free effort. And criticism is a way of understanding life. It is a mode of practice which should be simple, sincere, flexible, and ardent, as well as enriching in knowledge. It should connect criticism with creative power, and because criticism is a serious and solemn function, it should be recognized as an art form. Now, he also illustrates the qualities of a literary critic. He says that a critic must be involved in his work, and he should be easy in contributing his critical output, and should try to elevate the standards of existing literary art. He must have wide knowledge than the standards which are prevalent. And with his depth and nobility in content and style, he should extend the boundaries of existing knowledge along with. He should have psychological, historical, and sociological elements be kept aside when he makes his judgment. And his endeavor should be a purely an objective venture. It should not be biased. It should not be marred with his critical evaluation should be genuine. And at the same time, he should also have a ready knowledge of the mode of evaluation that is existing in other countries, apart from what he is using at that very moment. Arnold talks about the threefold function of the critic. He says that he must learn new things, spread noble ideas, and create an atmosphere to develop, grow, and rise. That is, he should see the object as in itself it really is, and he should not ascribe his personal views onto the literature that he is evaluating. For Arnold writes, which I quote, "He should have the finest fact, the nicest moderation, the most free, flexible, and elastic spirit imaginable." Along with this, he also says that a critic need to clarify and instruct, to play the role of a recognized authority, imposing a high standard in matters of intellect and taste. Coming to the distinction between creative faculty and critical faculty, Arnold establishes the opinion that both creative and critical are essential, and no creative activity can stand complete without critical activity. That is, both have a high obligation and duty to the society, and no great literature can be created without great critical effort behind it. So, excellent ideas and actions need both creative faculty as well as critical faculty. Now, he says that creative faculty uses fresh ideas in making of a text, whereas critical faculty discovers those fresh ideas by underlining it. And second is that creative faculty establishes an order of ideas, whereas critical faculty highlights. Critical faculty underlines the ordered ideas which are scattered and surfaces them. No? Then creative faculty nurtures newness, whereas critical faculty measures nourishment of the newness that is created. Creative faculty constructs intellectual substance for the society, which is very important, but it is the responsibility of critical faculty to highlight intellectual substance contained herein for the flourishment in society. In creative faculty, genuine creative communication and commitment are the watchwords, whereas in critical faculty, you find sincerity, impartiality, and fearlessness are the watchwords. Creative faculty constructs what is beautiful, but critical faculty distinguishes what is beautiful from what is not. Creative faculty utilizes concurrences of the power of the man and the power of the moment. But critical faculty concocts proper intellectual atmosphere for creativity to produce blend of good taste and intellects. Creative faculty cautions against dumping of internal expressions of impressions, whereas critical faculty cautions against dumb appreciation. So you find that Arnold cautions against poor, starved, fragmentary, and inadequate creation as well as critical judgment. And he demands a joyful sense of creativity to profit reader with insight and alert conscience. For creative activity provides great happiness, and critical faculty provide a proof of it by giving a feel of being totally alive. His ideas of disinterestedness created a lot of controversy, but it is also the vital element with which a critical enterprise can be performed. Arnold's approach to criticism is moralistic, and that is why he says that to keep aloof from human motives should be singularly the aim of a critic when he approaches a piece of creative output. And he should propagate the best that is known and thought in the world by moving spontaneously with the flux of the law of nature. He should not create his own laws, but should steer clean of the political and practical consideration. He should also facilitate a current of true and fresh ideas, because the value of a work of art cannot be discussed by analyzing it, but its value need to be felt and recognized. And he also says that it is through a disinterested approach that healthy criticism can become an appendage to school or to a group of thoughts. So here you find that through disinterestedness, he says that a detached viewpoint and assessment is very essential. It is a must requirement and is highly productive in case it is free of ignoble interests. But then Arnold's theory of disinterestedness is considered fallacious because of its intellectual interest, which are superseded by spiritual interest, too little and incoherent output. Now let us see what critics have to say on Arnold. We find that T.S. Eliot and F.R. Lewis, they have shown allegiance to his belief, whereas Tillotson describes his task as, I quote, He tells the contemporary truth as a barometer does. T.S. Eliot calls Arnold an advocate. To him, Arnold was, I quote, not occupied so much in establishing criticism as in attacking the uncritical. This he says in his writing, Sacred Woods. Thank you, students, for listening to me, and I hope that this deliberation is of much use to you. Thank you.